Thank you for that kind introduction. Hi, in case you don't know me, I'm Jeffrey, right? And I teach at LaSalle, right? And I just mentioned that you know, I run the MA program. Okay. Yeah. This year, of course, is a year of I think you all know, right? It's SG50, Singapore's 50th year of independence, and I think it's appropriate to look back also at what's happened. Right, in the last 50 years of Singapore art. So I suppose you might say this is just another activity, you know, SG50 activity, right? So we're going to look today at the 10 defining moments, okay, of Singapore art in the last 50 years. So from 1965 to 2015, okay? So you might be wondering why certain works or certain artists were not included, right? Maybe they come before this date, okay? But now, whenever we come up with lists, right, 10 defining moments, 10 greatest artists, 10 great works of art, there's always a certain subjectivity involved, okay? Right? I suppose when you do the selection, then, you know, it's important to state your criteria. Okay, but even having stated your criteria, that you know, you can't help. I mean, this question of inclusion exclusion, okay, is would inevitably cause certain debates and controversy, right? So I have to state categorically right now, right? Okay, make some qualification that this is not a definitive list, right? You might have your own top 10 list, all right? Okay, this is I would say Jeffrey says list. Right, of the 10 defining moments. Okay, and you might agree or disagree with some of the selections. Okay, and what will happen is this. Now, if you think certain, artists, or certain events should be included, then what we'll do is that, I'm going to leave a bit more time at the end, okay, where we can have some discussion. Right, and you tell me why you think this artist or this exhibition should be included in the list, and we would like to hear what you say, right? I think that would be interesting instead of me talking a lot of time, right? Okay. Instead of raising your hand and me like say I object, right? Okay. Well, we'll wait till the end, okay, and then you can kind of give your own take or own view on it. All right. So. When I first generated this list, it was randomly done at first, right? Okay, so what came into my mind, I would just randomly list down. Okay, and I found when I look at the list, right, that there's really a diversity of things in the list, right? You have exhibitions, okay. There's even a text, okay. There's even a policy paper, right? Okay, and a work of art. Okay, so then I consciously, made a list such that, right, the 10 items in the list, okay, in fact, come from each of those categories. Okay, so you have, a work of art, an exhibition, right, an art space. Right? Okay, so that was. Till the end, consciously done. Okay, although there, I think that there is one or two items that are in the same category, like art spaces. Okay. All right. So that's how the list was generated. Now, what is a defining moment? Okay, you might come up with some synonyms: watershed, groundbreaking, right? Seminal moment. Okay, a significant turn. Okay, so all those synonyms you can use, right, to describe what's a defining moment. Right? But I think it's well understood what we mean by defining moment. But I think that's not enough. Okay, it's still very subjective. So to justify what I mean by defining moment, okay, I've again generated some, I suppose, characteristics of what a defining moment is. Okay, so. You have, okay, firstly, it must further the discourse of Singapore art. Okay, when I say further the discourse, means that it must have been written about, talked about, circulated. Okay, something that has become well known, right, in the local art scene. Okay? And it must have shaped the development of the Singapore art scene somewhat. For example, in terms of the infrastructure, right? Okay, the establishment of art spaces, for example. Making the scene more vibrant, right? Whatever it is. And the third point is broke new grounds. Okay, now, I mean, that's subjective. Right? I mean, I won't say that anything that is first must be included in the list, right? Okay, but there are certain events which are that important that must be included in the list, right? So seminal first, something that breaks new grounds, something that push boundaries. And the fourth point is until a radical shift in art practice. Okay, so you have, for example, artists, right, doing works which really created a radical shift in art practice here in Singapore. And through his work or her work, right, also exerted an influence on other artists. Okay, and then the fifth point, contributed to the international success of Singaporean artists. Okay, so here we are talking about, Singapore art, okay, going global, artists achieving international success. Okay, so what were the factors which caused that? Okay, so there were certain developments in the last 50 years, okay, that enabled Singaporean artists to achieve that kind of success. And the last point, okay, to make this list, you also have to include, for example, maybe a space, an art space, okay, something that, establish a critical space for the making, display, and discussion of contemporary art. Okay, I think that's important. Okay, able to create a kind of alternative space for the discussion of contemporary art. Okay. All right, so I don't know whether this is an exhaustive, by no means, right, I would say this criteria is exhaustive, but it actually guides my selection of the top 10, or not top 10, right, the 10 defining moments. Okay, so the 10 defining moments, really, I'm not going to present to you, but in no particular order. Okay, so it doesn't mean 10 is the least, and, okay, number one is the top of the list, right, in no particular order. And I didn't put them also in chronological kind of arrangement. Okay. Right. So again, I've kind of randomly generated the list. All right, so I'm going to start with 10. The 10th defining moment. Okay, the Singapore Biennale. Is that a surprise? Okay, probably not. Right. I think today, they just announced in the Straits Times that they're going to hold the next Biennale, or what we call Biennale, right, next year in October. Okay, but the very first one was held in 2006. Okay, and the fact that it's the first one, also broke certain grounds, I think, or helped to shape the development of Singapore art. Right. Now, there was a lot of I don't know whether you can call it controversy, okay, when it was first announced that Singapore would join the ranks of other cities, right, to hold this kind of mega exhibitions, right? And a lot of it see this decision to hold the Biennale at that point in 2006 as a political move. Okay? Right, if you recall, okay, in 2006, okay, Singapore was hosting, right, the 16,000 delegates of the World Bank and the International Monetary Fund in Singapore. Right, so many see this Biennale as a kind of a showcase, okay, of Singapore's ambition to be a global city of the arts. Right, okay, to be an arts hub. Okay, but whatever it is, I think, whatever motivation it is, I think, for me at least personally, this was the most memorable of all the Biennales that have been shown so far. Okay, I think, let me show you some pictures. All right, that's a catalog. Okay, and each Biennale have a theme. Okay, and the theme of this particular Biennale is called Belief. Right, Belief. And there were altogether about 95 artists from about 38 countries. Okay. And it's memorable because, you know, there were some, I would say, big name artists who participated. I remember, I don't know whether you all recall any of those names. Okay, it was a mixture of both. I think there were more international artists than local artists. Okay, of course, you know, it was not free from criticism, right? I mean, one criticism is that, you know, I mean, more local artists were being represented, and they sort of addressed that in, you know, subsequent Biennales. Okay, anyone recall any names? I remember Yayoi Kusama, Jenny Holzer, right? Okay, who projected her truisms, okay, on City Hall. Okay, any more? Singaporean artists, some of Singaporean artists who participated. Okay, we had Donna Ong, Goh Soon Yen. Right, so why, I mean, and it's also memorable for the space itself because it made use of both the Supreme Court and the City Hall, which of course are now going to be the National Gallery, right, come October. Right, and you know, number of artists made use of the space quite effectively, especially the chambers, the judges' chambers. Okay, like for example, Jane Alexander for her work, right, of these hybrid creatures, you know. I mean, it's really a satire about truth and justice and all that. Okay, and I mean, I included the Biennale not only because it's the very first one, okay, but because of its impact, okay, on Singapore art and Singaporean artists. Okay, and I think the greatest impact is this. I mean, of course, let me just show you a quote. Sorry, but I think I better for me to stand here. Okay. I mean, if you look at the first, click too fast, right? Of course, I mean, you know, the Biennale, the aim is to position Singapore as an international center and regional thought leader in the field of visual art, and also allowing Singaporean artists to engage with international artists. That has definitely been achieved, okay? And for Singapore to join the international community of art Biennales, okay, I think that's the greatest impact of the 2006 Biennale. Okay, because whenever you have Biennales, you have curators from many countries coming over, right, to look at the works. Okay, and subsequently, you know, some of the artists are going to be invited to participate, okay, in these Biennales overseas, right? And I remember, you know, after this Biennale, you know, people like Donna Ong, Goh Soon Yen, they were invited, okay, to participate, you know, internationally in other Biennales. And today, you know, I mean, artists like them have, you know, established themselves internationally, getting invited to do shows overseas. So I think for me, that's really the greatest impact, right? Okay, no matter what criticism you can have about the kind of motivation behind your Biennale, for example, Wee Wan Leung, in a kind of a soft critique of the Biennale, right? Okay, says that it is tied with global capitalism, right? I mean, of course, I mean, the economic imperative, pragmatism, always comes into play, and we can't avoid that, right? I mean, it's not only the Singapore Biennale, it's with Biennales worldwide, even the Venice Biennale, right? Okay, it's tied with, you know, global capitalism, right? Okay, but we have to assess, right, the impact in terms of how it shaped the local art scene. Okay, so to me that's significant. Okay, the fact that it allowed artists, right, to achieve, you know, success abroad. Okay, maybe, you know, I can see your faces. You might not agree with me, fine. Right? You can, or you might think that, well, maybe the 2013 Biennale is more important, right? Because it's the first time where you know, it's primarily you know, works by Singapore and South Asian artists. Okay, ninth defining moment. Wow, you might be surprised as it is, right? What's the report doing in the right in this defining moment? But okay, it's the report of the Advisory Council on Culture and Arts. You all recognize this buildings, of course. Okay, you have the Esplanade or Esplanade. Then the Singapore Museum and the National Arts Council. Now, all this would not have been realized, okay, all right, if not for that report, which I just mentioned. Okay, because the advisory council was formed in 1988. Right, it was a very high-powered council, chaired by the late Ong Teng Cheong, okay, who was then the Deputy Prime Minister. Mr. Cheong, I think you remember that, right? Yeah, I don't know whether you were involved in that.
Well, I remember Mr. Ong.
Oh,
definitely.
Okay.
No, I'm not involved in this.
Right. Okay, that's the. It's a very thin book. I mean, you know, it's like you can call it a white paper, a blueprint. Okay. You know, but the vision that's set inside, okay, was really, it was very groundbreaking, I feel. You know, it recognized that there were, you know, in the 1980s, Singapore was called a cultural desert. Yep, right, a cultural desert. Right, so the government felt that they have to do, you know, something about this, right? Okay, so they formed a committee, okay, to look at the state of the arts here. Okay, and I mean, and they felt that, you know, the vision was really to turn Singapore into a culturally vibrant, you know, arts hub by 1999. Okay, I don't know whether that's been achieved by 99, but I think by 1999, by the turn of the millennium, I think a lot of things have been done, right? And they felt that the arts can add to the quality of life, okay? And, you know, add to the vitality of the city. Okay, and of course, benefit certain sectors like the tourism and entertainment sectors. Okay, again, that's the economic imperative. Okay, I mean, the government, you know, noted that, you know, the arts help to generate revenue. Okay, you know, in many other cities in the world. Right, but because of this report, today we have all this. The National, okay, what they call the Singapore National Arts Council is now the NAC. National Heritage Trust, the National Heritage Board. Right, the teaching of art and design at tertiary level has been has really been enhanced in both NAFA, Nanyang Academy of Fine Arts, and LaSalle. Okay. And also SOTA, you know, they also mentioned a school, and that school in the report eventually was to become the School of the Arts, SOTA. And you also mentioned that, you know, about establishing a library, okay, and that's the NLB we have today in Bras Basah. And also establishment of Fine Art Gallery in the former St. Joseph Institution, SAN. Okay. Extension of the Fine Arts Gallery, which should become the National Gallery, which will open in October. Can you see the vision is far-reaching? Right? This was in 1989. Right? Okay, and lastly, to construct a new performing arts center, which became yesterday. So I consider the report a very, of course there were other iterations after the other versions, like the Renaissance City, okay, which sought to make, you know, turn Singapore into a global city of the arts. And the most recent iteration is the Arts and Culture Strategic Review 2013. Okay, which really saw the arts, in developing the arts from the grounds up, okay, to work more with the community. So you see a lot of government agencies today working with communities, you know, plenty, right? Okay, especially this year. Okay. Right. So the eighth defining moment. Now it was a tussle, you know. I mean, you know, I tried to choose between the two, but I can't. Okay, so I had to put them together, all right? And this was the first sculpture exhibition in 1967, okay, which probably not many of you have heard of, okay, except Mr. Choi, because Mr. Choi here curated that show. He's still here today. So,
it's a very small show. That's the beginning, you know? Very small.
No, he's being modest, right? Okay, that's not what he said in his foreword, right? If you read the foreword, right, in the catalog, okay?
It is.
Yeah. Okay, and the 1991 sculpture exhibition. Okay, two shown on sculpture, but very differently presented, right? And very different works inside. Okay, let me just talk briefly about the first sculpture exhibition. There were altogether 7 participating artists, 116 works, okay, of various. I mean, I was just taken in by the, you know, not only by the number of works, but the number of, you know, the kinds of different materials, okay, you know, that the artists use to make their works, right? Both small scale as well as, you know, life size. Okay, and these are the 7 participating artists. And, you know, at that time, you know, sculpture was really secondary to painting. Right? This was really the first sculpture show held on a kind of national level. Right. And for various reasons, you know, I mean, sculpture didn't really take off in Singapore. I mean, the most famous sculptor you can say was Ng Yin Teng, right? Okay, but other than that, sculpture was, for example, was never taught formally in schools. Okay, a lot of these so-called sculptors were actually self-taught or they were taught overseas, right? Okay, so this was an important show, and it was held at the National Library. Okay, the National Library. And these were the 7 participating artists. Not all are actually pure sculptors. Okay, there were only a few pure sculptors, meaning to say that, okay, quite a number of them are actually both painters as well as sculptors. Like Cheong Soo Ping, of course, many of you know Cheong Soo Ping today, one of our so-called Nanyang artists. And Cheong Soo Ping was, you know, famous for his metal reliefs. Right, he was very innovative in that sense in using, you know, ordinary, everyday found objects, okay, for this kind of, you know, constructions, metal constructions that he made. Okay, and then you have people like Lim Yu Kwan, who is the son of the founder of NAFA, Lim Hak Tai, okay, who was also primarily a painter, but he also sculpted. Okay, and then you have Ng Teng, of course. Ng Teng was both a potter as well as sculptor, Ng Teng. Ao Ing Kwang, who was known, in fact, best known for being a sculptor, a potter, in fact, rather than a sculptor. Okay, and then you have, let me see, if I missed out on, okay, let me just show you 2 other sculptors, very important sculptors. Okay, and, you know, sculpture is something, you know, that I have a personal interest in. Okay, I've been, you know, researching on sculpture for more than 10 years. Right. Okay, because it's an area that has not really been researched, or very little research has been done. Okay, so I'm quite happy to learn that the National Gallery is devoting, I think, you know, a space, right, to showcase sculpture, right, in the new National Gallery. Okay, so you have Yeo Wee Bin, okay, who is first and foremost a sculptor. And Hui Bin was someone who was very versatile. He could work with you know, different kinds of materials. He could work with different styles. Okay, he could do abstract sculptures, semi-abstract like this one, or even realistic sculptures. Okay. And then you have Vincent Hoisington. I think Mr. Choi would remember Vincent Hoisington very fondly. Okay, quite a character, right? Okay. You know, I mean, in my research also, I had to interview Mr. Choi, right? And Vincent Hoisington, you know, he said that, you know, in the 60s, you know, when, if you walk, let's say, in the town area of Singapore, okay, it's inevitable that you'll come across, okay, one of Vincent Hoisington's work, right? Either in a hotel lobby, or in Robinson's, or John Little's, for example, okay? And he specialized in making this so-called, you know, you can call it relief sculptures or metal reliefs. Okay, he works with aluminium. Okay, a very kind of unique style that he developed. Okay, that in fact spurned a lot of copycats. Okay, later on, right? But it's really unfortunate that many of these works, you know, I tried to trace many of these works, but okay, I couldn't find really any. Right, I had to go through his daughter to kind of try to locate them. Okay, many of them are with collectors, but many of these public works are now, they've disappeared. They're gone, right, unfortunately. very interesting character. I mean, he was influenced in his own work by music and by Egyptian art even. Right? Okay, and then come the 1991 exhibition. I would say the 1991 exhibition was the third large-scale exhibition. Okay, you had one in the... Okay, after the 1967 show, they had... The 1969, they had another show held in the Victoria Theatre, right, by the same seven artists. And then in the 19... Then they went to Malaysia, they had another show. And then in the 1970s, there was another large-scale show. Okay, and there were works by Brother McNally, Ng Eng Teng, and people like that. And then the 1991 show was really the third kind of national level show. Right? Now, you might be shocked, right? To see this in a sculpture show. Right? Okay, I was just talking to Belinda, right? about, the docents, in the upcoming national, they are having to talk about Faisal Fadil's work. Now, what do you talk about it? What can you say? Right? Okay. I mean, it's a Duchampian kind of work, I mean, Duchamp did that in the 1920s or earlier, okay, with his ready-mates, okay, where he actually bought, second-hand, objects from, from the shop and then exhibited them as art, okay? And, and declared them as artworks. Right, so, and it's interesting, I feel that, the artist calls it study. It's not only three thermos flasks, but study of three thermos flasks. Okay, so he's appropriating here an academic language, to talk about art. And he wants you to pay serious attention, right, to these three thermos flasks. Okay, and a work by Zhou Zhaihyang, again, using ordinary found objects, combining them into a kind of assemblage. Right? Okay? So this is what, the works there, of course there were some conventional works. Conventional works means sculptures that have mass, volume, okay, that involves a transformation of material. Conventional freestanding works. Okay? I mean, they were included in the show as well. Those by Brother Joseph McNally, Ng Eng Teng, Chong Fa Cheong, people like that. But you have such works which push the boundaries of what sculpture is. Right? But there is nothing new, in the international art world. In 1979, okay, an art critic called Rosalind Krauss, art historian, wrote a very important paper called Sculpture in the Expanded Field. Right? You can get it actually free from, on the internet. Right? And, in that paper, right, she said that there were many surprising things that have been called art. Right, in recent years, okay, television monitors along the corridors, mirrors placed in odd angles in the room. Okay, those things have been called sculpture. Okay, so she said that, maybe the notion of sculpture should not be limited. It should be more elastic. Right? Okay, to include objects that are not conventionally defined as sculpture. Right? So this idea, okay, was nothing new, right? Okay, but in Singapore, it was quite radical. Right, it was quite radical. Now, if you can, you can get a hold of the 1991 sculpture catalog, in which our art historians, T.K. Sabapati, interviewed, Tang Da Wu and a few of the participating artists, and they can tell you that, to them, right, sculpture is all about investigation. Interrogation, investigating, language, processes, systems, okay, rather than, consider the finished product to be the most important thing, right? Okay, so really so the 1991 show was important in redefining what sculpture is, especially in the local context. Okay, the seventh defining moment. Okay, the opening of Substation. Now, I was kind of torn, I considered some of the important art spaces. Sam, of course, is one of them. Now, you might have Sam on your list, of course. Right. Okay, but I think SAM was devoted more to the wider Southeast Asian region and not only to Singapore. Right? But I think the substation played an important role, okay, in developing, okay, our local artists and local art. Right? And I mean, the substation, as you know, was that's how it got its name. It was an old power station, okay, and the playwright, okay, you know, the famous playwright, late playwright Kuo Pao Kun, okay, then made a proposal to the government to turn that power station into an art space. Right? He was a visionary in many ways as well, Kuo Pao Kun, okay, and he saw that, you know, an alternative art space is needed as well. Okay. Okay, for a discussion of art that is outside the mainstream. Okay, so you see here the substation, a picture taken in 2006. You know, I have fond memories of the substation. You know, I used to work in the National Museum as curator for a couple of years. Right? And we used to work in containers, you know. We were so bad, right? In containers, actually. Right? I mean, it was just a temporary space, right? I think it was behind, just next to the substation. Okay, and I used to visit the substation almost every day to use the toilet there. Right? Okay, but actually, also it's an excuse to look at some of the works there as well, right? Okay, so for almost 2 years, you know, right? I mean, I was visiting the substation daily. Okay, and I remember it very fondly, I mean, especially the garden. The garden. I mean, for those who have been, you know, in the substation, in the early days, you won't forget the garden, right? Because it's in the garden where a lot of these so-called alternative performances took place, right? Music by indie bands, you know, metal bands, rock bands, okay, performances as well, okay, multi-disciplinary performances. Okay, for example, the tree celebration by Kuo Pao Kun, it was held in the garden, all right? And really the substation, at least in its formative years, in the first 5 years, became a very important space, okay, in the local art scene, okay, and many of the important kind of events, art events, took place in the substation, okay, and the substation subsequently became a very important incubator, right, for young artists to experiment, okay, it was really an experimental art space, right, okay, where don't worry about failing. You know, as Kuo Pao Kun says, in the arts, a worthy failure is more important than a mediocre success. And you know, you had very memorable shows like Jason Lim, okay, and Ng Siu Kuan's work, Three Tons of Clay, okay, where the whole gallery, the whole space was filled with clay, right? And audience can do whatever they want, right? They wanted. Okay, you know, to mold the space. And you know, a lot of other things were happening in the substation. That I remember there were seminars, right, on contemporary art. Okay, there were quite a few important seminars on contemporary art being held in the substation, right? And also, of course, not to mention cutting edge exhibitions as well, right? Shows. Okay, but unfortunately, in the last few years, you know, I mean, I don't know. The substation is, I don't know, gradually losing its reputation, you know, as kind of cutting edge. Some of you agree with me. Okay, and I think it could be due to a couple of reasons. What do y'all think? Do y'all agree with me? I don't know. G? Yes. You agree, right? Okay, I think, I mean, okay, maybe they blame it on the gentrification of the area. You know, maybe, right? Okay, it used to be, you know, I remember the coffee shop opposite, right? Okay, right. Famous for its fried kway teow, the char kway teow, and wow, you know, yeah. But it's not only the food, but it allows people to congregate, you know, together. Artists coming together in a community. Okay, and once you an area is gentrified, you know, you lose all that kind of charm and all that. Okay, which is a magnet for attracting artists, right? So although, you know, the substation continues to promote, you know, experimental cutting edge art, I think it's no longer what it used to be. Okay, and the garden has now been turned into a bistro, yeah, a cafe, right? Okay, it's gone as well. Six defining moments. Okay? The three Murti. Now again, I don't know whether, okay, many of you have heard. Probably not many of you, I would say, have heard of this. I would call it an exhibition, but it can very well be the name of this collective as well. Okay? The three Murti. Now the three Murti is a term borrowed from Hinduism. Okay, to refer to the triad of the Hindu religion, right? Shiva, Vishnu, and Brahma, right? And who are these three? This Trimurti, right? This roles were assumed by these three artists. Okay, from left to right. Goichu, Sarejapa, and Chandrasekhar. Okay, today all of them are my colleagues. Okay, Sale and Chandra they are teaching there full time, while Ichu, okay, is a part time lecturer. Okay, at that time they freshly graduated from NAFA. Imagine, I mean, of all places, you know, NAFA. But of course, looking at them, okay, I won't say they were not very diligent students, but it was students who went against the system, who couldn't accept the system, right? Okay, and of course, not long after they graduated, they came together, right, to hold this exhibition in the Goethe Institute, okay, the Goethe Institute, right? And so each of them assumed, as I said, one of the three Murti. Okay, gods. Goichu became the preserver. Okay, Brahma. Saleh, the creator. Okay. Goichu was Vishnu, the preserver. Saleh, the creator. Brahma, the creator. And Chandrasekharan, right, the destroyer, right, Shiva. Okay. And they managed to turn this whole space, okay, transforming into a kind of energy space in a way, right? Okay, and I think what's important, I mean, let's go to the quote by Sabapati, right? Two reasons why this, I mean, of course, I mean, if you not many of you have heard of the Trimurti, because I think it's not as well circulated, I mean, or written about compared, let's say, to the Artist Village, okay, but is as important as the Artist Village in terms of breaking new grounds, okay, in the local art scene, right? I think it did that in two ways, all right? Now, firstly, you know, if you look at the images here, right? I think it was perhaps the first show, okay, to really make use or utilize multiple modes of, you know, practice or making art. Okay, so because in this space, you know, I mean, in a way, the artist was trying to challenge what a gallery space should be. Okay, so in this space, you had the three of them, okay, not only doing installation works, installation works, there were paintings, sculptures, there was also performances, as well taking place. Right? Okay, so that was an important groundbreaking moment, right, at that point in time in Singapore art. And then secondly, as Sabapati says, that's really an interdisciplinary thing I'm talking about, right? Okay, making use of multiple modes of art making. And also, they wanted to depart from, you know, at that time, you know, a lot of Singapore artists were influenced by Western art, Western thinking, Western philosophy. Okay, here, the three artists wanted to get away from that and draw from their own heritage and culture. Of course, they were saying is that, you know, at that time there was a lot of talk about multiculturalism in Singapore as well. So, okay, by coming together, Chinese, Indian, and Malay, right, it was a kind of, in a sense, a political statement, you know, to some extent. Okay, but I think it's important also that they also drew from their own culture and heritage, right, okay, as a basis for this exhibition. I'm going to show you very quickly a short interview with Chandra and Ichu, If for some reason Salim wasn't present, it was shown in this, I think it was shown not long ago in Okto or Channel News Asia. Okay, this series on Singapore art. I think there was a three-part series. Okay, so the last part was on contemporary art. Okay, let me just end this video. Okay. I'm Mashadi, we'll come to him later. How the volume cannot work? Okay, never mind. Just. Okay, we come to the last five defining moments. Okay, now maybe you know, I'm not including this because I'm from LaSalle. Okay, I've thought long and hard about you know, being subjective and about biasness and all that. You know, but I have my reasons, I mean, very good reasons for including LaSalle College of the Arts. And, you know, today I'm so happy to see two of my former students here, Imran and John, right? Yeah, okay, John. Who just graduated a master's, I just said, right, from the Chinese University of Hong Kong. Okay, right, so, LaSalle College of the Arts. And there are only, three art schools in Singapore, tertiary, you know, art schools. So you have NAFA, right, which of course is important. I mean, if you were to tell me, you know what, the most important art school in the last 100 years, I would have a difficult time. Okay, choosing between NAFA and LaSalle, but because we are looking essentially at contemporary art today, and I think LaSalle plays a very important role in that. And of course, we have the ADM, the Art Design and Media School in NTU, right? Now LaSalle just celebrated its 30 years, its 30th year last year. Okay, so it's been in existence for 30 years. Okay, founded by Brother Joseph McNally. Okay, who was, besides being a man of the cloth and, you know, an educator, he was also a well-known sculptor, right? And I think what makes, LaSalle important, firstly, I think it's because of his pedagogy, okay, meaning to say that, you know, his teaching approaches. And, you know, many have compared the teaching approaches between NAFA and LaSalle, right? You know, and they will tell you that, you know, NAFA adopt a very conservative approach to teaching. Okay, they'll teach you the skills and all that, the techniques. Okay, whereas LaSalle would focus more on ideas and concepts. Okay, and students at LaSalle cannot draw. Okay, that's not true. Okay, no. But I think, it's two very important, I mean, two very different approaches. Right, I think I suppose, you know, students in LaSalle, they are a bit more experimental in their approach. Okay, they dare to kind of push boundaries, right? Okay, and that's how, you know, many of the graduates, you know, from LaSalle, okay, has in fact made an impact on the contemporary art scene, right? Okay, because of the teaching, the pedagogical kind of approach, right? In LaSalle, right? So we used to be in Goodman campus, right? LaSalle started out as a small. It started out in St. Patrick's School, where brother was, a principal then. Okay, and then later we moved to Tuan Kura, okay, and then to Goodman campus. Okay, I've been teaching 17 years in LaSalle, so you know I've been in both campuses and. You know, I mean, Goodman campus, you have been there, you know, has own charm altogether, right? Okay, which you can't replicate in a city campus. Okay, but the city campus has a nice building, right? I mean, one building of the year and all that, if you have been to the LaSalle campus, the McNally campus. All right, and I think what's important, right, besides the pedagogical, the teaching approach, right, adopted at LaSalle is that it's alumni. Right, the impact, okay, made by its alumni on the Singapore art scene. Sorry, I think in your handout you only have five. Okay, I've forgotten to include Lee Wen, right? Very important artist. Okay, I think you are familiar with at least most of these artists. Amanda Heng, okay, who is really a a pioneer in what you call relational aesthetics, where you know her works involve audience participation. Okay, and she's also a pioneer in taking up gender issues, right, in art. And then Vincent Liao, all right, who once upon a time drank his own urine. Okay, and but you know Vincent Liao is a performance artist. I mean, he's a multi-disciplinary artist, right? Performance artist, painter, and all that. And today teaching at SOTA. Okay, and his work is always about a satire, okay, about capitalism and consumerism. Okay, and here he's shown with his alter ego called Andy. Okay, I think you've seen this so-called hybrid dog, Andy. And then Lee Wen, of course, okay, needs no introduction. I mean, you know, Yellow Man, his most famous work of art, right? Where, you know, he performed in many countries, right, by painting himself yellow, right? And the bracket, okay, that's the class of 1988, right? And then Choy Kay, right? Who, in fact, took up art quite late, right, in his career. Okay, he first studied at La Salle, right? And then he also had a lot of grounding in Chinese painting and calligraphy under Fang Changtian, okay, the famous, Chinese ink painter. Right? But at the same time, he also enrolled in La Salle and also went to Australia to study. So he had the best of both worlds. I mean, so his art, in a sense, you know, crossed a bridge between East, the East and West divide. Okay? So his work really is a reinterpretation of Chinese ink painting, drawing from both traditions. Right? And Jane Lee, not to mention, I mean, Jane Lee, right, today very successful. I mean, it's not surprising. I mean, she works hard and, you know, she's also very innovative in how she makes use of the structure, the canvas, the paint, right? And her works often approach that of sculpture, you know, right? It's three-dimensional, right? Sometimes going all the way to the floor, using only paint. And today she's represented by Sundaram Tagore. I mean, commercially, she's very successful. And of course, the latest addition, right, to this Masalama is Ruben Pang. Okay? And I don't know, I think some of you have heard of Ruben Pang. Okay? And Ruben Pang is also very experimental in his work. Also a very hardworking, you know, artist. You know, he in his work, he uses resin and oil. Okay, he would kind of scratch or erase the paint using his hand, using sandpaper, right, using a brush. Okay, so yes, so I suppose LaSalle kind of instills that kind of experimental spirit, right, in his students. Okay, and then that is why they're able to make, okay, a kind of an imprint or impact on the contemporary art scene. Okay, and I don't know whether you all are looking at your paper or know what the, okay, hold on. Okay, so the fourth defining moment. How can I leave this out, right? The artist village. Okay, because the artist village is almost synonymous with contemporary art. Okay, and they were being well written about. Okay, by historians like T.K. Sabapati. And the artist village is at its peak, I believe there are over 30 so-called if you can call them members. I suppose it's an art collective, okay? A loose collective, I would say, but a collective nonetheless. Okay? And for a time, they had a kind of artist colony in what was then Ulu Sembawang, okay? And they had an address, 61B Lorong Gambas. I don't know whether it still exists, right? 61B. Okay, it was, chicken farms, you know, being converted into art studios, right? And of course, the leader of the artist village was Tang Da Wu, the enigmatic, elusive Tang Da Wu. It's not easy to get an interview with Tang Da Wu, right? Okay. And T.K. Sabapati, who was responsible for writing about the early history of the artist village, Okay, he observed when he was attending the Open Studio, one of the first shows that the Artist Village held. Okay, in Lorong Gambas itself. Okay, he says, these 10 artists have been drawn together by their common aims and methods of work. Okay, they are interested in art as a continuous process. Okay, instead of a finished work. Right, and they aim to draw the viewer into an active, dynamic relationship with the work, the artist and the process of creation. Okay, so this group of artists, okay, collectively banded as Artist Village. Okay, they created art that sought to challenge the mainstream. Right, and at that time the mainstream was painting, sculpture, maybe printmaking, okay, photography. Right, so they held. I mean, they did installation works, performances, okay, and you know all those kind of experimental practices. Okay. And the three, some of the Lhasa alumni were founding members of the Artist Village. Vincent Liao, Amanda Heng, Lee Wen. Okay, the three of them. But the three Moti, Saleh, Chandra, Ichu, okay, were not part of the... So there were groups that were not part of the Artist Village, they were quite important as well. Okay, and we have to remember that. Okay, but the Artist Village seems to have been the most written about, okay, collective. There's also the 4x4. Right, Tamangki, Tingkang, okay, and a couple more, right, who did work in, at the time when St. Joseph was abandoned, they did work there. Also very important, it's about 1988. Okay, so we have to remember that there were such groups working as well at that time, besides the Artist Village. Okay, the top left, photograph, right, shows you the signage that says, okay, Artist Village, this way, right? Unfortunately, they only lasted there 2 years before it was up for urban renewal, right? Yeah, and then they became artists without any space, So they had to, perform in temporary spaces like Hong Lee Warehouse, right? Hong Lee Warehouse. And Parkway Parade, for example. Okay. So, they were doing things like that, works like this, right? Performance, art. Okay, and then, if you look at the bottom left picture, there's an SPS bus. You see four of these, who are these people, four of them in one suit, coming down the bus. Okay, it's Tang Da Wu, Zai Kuning, who is also, who has become quite well known, And Ahmad Mashari, today the head of the NUS Museum. Okay. Some of you never knew he was an artist. Okay. But I think for a while he was an artist. Okay. Right? So to see that happening at that time was, you don't see this happening today anymore. It's such a thing. It would be very interesting to see works like this. Right? Okay. Instead of everyone rushing for the MRT, so you have works like this in public space, which would really add to the vibrancy of the space here. Okay, that's Zai Kuning, right? Performing in Hong Lee Warehouse, right? In a very important time show. Okay, and right, that's the press coverage of the artist coming. So there was a lot of talk in the press, okay, at that time, right? About what is art? Okay, they're questioning whether what the Artist Village was doing was art, right? Okay, so it took some time, right, for people to kind of. Even today, some people, right, still have difficulty accepting such works as art. Okay, but they were very important, right, the Artist Village, in breaking new grounds. Okay, in terms of their influence as well on contemporary art, unmistakable, right? And okay, so we come to the last three. Now this one probably will cause the most controversy. Right, you might not agree. Tang Sui Hian's record-breaking painting, 2nd December 2012. Okay. Now, firstly, you might be wondering, why is it, am I talking about something commercial here, in this top 10 defining moments? Okay. Then why not include Art Stage? Why not include Gilman Barracks? Okay. Or even Affordable Art Fair? Okay, I'm not sure. Alright. Okay, but we can discuss that later. Right, but for me, okay, I think this record-breaking sale by Tan Sui Hian On 2nd December 2012 was a defining moment. Now this was a work that was sold. Okay, and all an acrylic work is called When the Moon is Hot. Right. And it sold for, anyone can remember? Anyway, it sold in Poly Auctions. Now Poly Auction is part of the Poly Group of companies in China. State-owned company. Now anyone can remember how much this work was sold? $3.7 million.
Singapore.
Yes, Singapore. And the highest grossing sale by a living Singaporean artist, okay, was sold in May that year by Lim Tze Peng, right? Lim Tze Peng has sent some works here for $80,000. So this was $3.7 million.
Why?
Why? Okay. Why? I know that's a lot of questions. I mean, there's a lot of stories going on, you know, about how he managed to, you know, achieve such a record, right? I mean, of course, some people, it's something personal, you know. I mean, to them, I mean, Sui Hian, you know, in a sense, is also a controversial figure, but the fact is that he broke the record. Okay, as to why, okay, we cannot pinpoint a single reason. There's probably a confluence of factors, complexity of factors. Okay, but it's on record that this work sold for $3.7 million, right? Okay, but maybe I was actually interviewed by the Straits Times. Okay, I think the day after the record was broken, right? And I gave my response, right? And I kind of highlighted, you know, words in yellow there. Okay, that I felt, you know, I had come through. I mean, in the next few years, I said, you know, we will see the prices of works by Singapore artists rising to new heights. Okay, that's what I said, you know, the day after the record was broken. Okay, and if you were to analyze the market for Singapore, you know, works by Singapore artists in the last few years, you'll see that if you have a graph, you know, it's going up, the graph, right? And you see artists, you know, at that time it was unheard of for artists even to reach a seven-figure mark, okay? At that time in 2012, I mean, Cheong Soo Pyng was selling works for $600,000, but, you know, he never reached the million mark, okay? But today, it's not uncommon for, you know, Cheong Soo Pyng, right? For his works to sell for seven figures, or even Georgette Chen. Okay, or some of the Nanyang artists. Okay? And I will argue that Tan Sui Hian was the one, his work set the benchmark, okay, for prizes for the works by Singaporean artists. Now you might again beg to differ, okay, but you know, I felt that, you know, that's a defining moment. Okay, in terms of the art market, right, for Singapore works. And for Tan Sui Hian to break into the China market was also significant. And that, I mean, he surpassed his own record in 2014 with this work. Right? Now this is an ink work. Okay? So quite different from the other one. Right? And it's a portrait of Bada Shandren, of course, one of the Hmong artists, right, in the Ming dynasty. And it sold for $4.4 million. Also at Poly Auction. Right? And I mean, of course, Sui Hian claimed that he did this work in a frenzied 1 minute. Okay, so probably in a Zen-like frenzy. I mean, it's not surprising. I mean, at that time, the Chan, the Zen Buddhist painters, okay, they could execute works in a matter of minutes. Okay, so perhaps Tan Sui Hian had mastered that kind of, you know, technique. All right. Okay, so we have two more to go. Right. The Joseph Ng incident. Now anyone, can I have a show of hands? How many? I would like to know. How many of you have heard of the Joseph Ng incident? Mr. Joy, yeah? Okay. Right? Okay. Okay, some of you have something. Very important, you have to know. Okay, although some people say it's infamous, okay, it's infamous, but nonetheless, I think, the impact from this episode, okay, was quite significant. Right, now what happened in 1994? Was this? Yes, okay, anyway, in any case, this incident happened during an arts event. Okay, it's called the Artists General Assembly. Right, organized jointly by the Fifth Passage, an art collective, and the Artist Village. Right, and it was held at Parkway Parade. Okay. So during this event, Joseph Ng and another artist, Shannon Tan, did a performance. Okay, so for this performance, the performance was a protest piece. Okay, Joseph Ng wanted the performance to protest against the way that 12 gay men had been arrested in Tanjung Rhu. Okay, and also how this was reported in the newspaper. So he did a performance piece, which was like a kind of protest piece. Okay, so he made use of he put towels. On the towel, he had a newspaper cut out from their report. And then tofu, you know tofu, right? And then plastic with red dye on it. Right, so 12, represented 12 men. Okay, and then he will hold a rotan. Okay, because the 12 men arrested were also given 3 strokes of the cane. Okay, hence the title of the work, Brother Cain. Okay, it was another Brother Cain. Okay, and so he went around in a kind of ritualistic movement, okay, hitting each of the red dye, the plastic bag and the tofu, and everything spattered. Okay, the red dye spattered tofu and all that. Okay. Now nothing controversial about that, but then he decided to do something more. Okay, and he said there is a kind of silent protest. Okay, he went to corner, right, pulled down his brief, and cut his pubic hair. Right, snipped off his pubic hair. And that's why it was reported in a newspaper. Okay, the headline, pubic or public protest. Okay, right. And of course, the authorities came up, and Shannon Tang, his collaborator, okay, she burned the new paper, okay, and then I think mixed it with water and drank it and then vomited out the contents. Okay, as a protest piece as well. So she was also arrested, and both of them were arrested. And the authorities came down hard on them. Okay, this is what the National Council says. NAC finds the act vulgar and completely distasteful, which deserve public condemnation. Right. Okay, and right, so they came down hard. Now, to keep a long story short, Fifth Passage had to quit its premises. I mean, it was given space to perform at Parkway Parade. Okay, but then, after this, they had to quit their premises. Okay, they were not given any support anymore, right, in terms of any events that they organized. And they slowly faded from the scene, unfortunately. And of course, for Joseph Ng and Shannon Tang, both of them were banned from performing for life. Well, at least until now, okay, they are still banned from doing any work, or at least performance work in Singapore. Right? Okay, so today Joseph Ng is working. He used to work in Thailand. I think now he's in China. But he wasn't jailed or anything. I think he was given a $1,000 fine, okay, for I think an act of public indecency. Alright? And for 10 years, okay, the government or NAC stopped giving support to performance art. 10 years. Okay? So if you talk about a negative effect, that's a negative effect. So for 10 years, right, the Singapore art scene, We ran back 10 years behind our neighbors, Indonesia, the Philippines. Right? there was a positive effect as well to all this, right? Now, number one is that, you know, this is probably one of the most circulated kind of episode in Singapore art, right? Okay, especially when it comes to discussing issues relating to the state and to censorship, right? Okay, so it has become like a cause célèbre of, you know, for to talk about, right, censorship issues in Singapore. Okay, and you know, many groups have cited this particular episode, okay, to press for easing of censorship laws in Singapore. Okay, so I suppose the authorities heard, you know, what all these groups have been saying, and this can be seen, for example, in 2012 when Loo Zihan, re-enacted Brother Kane in the substation, right? Okay, and he went further than Joseph Ng. He went further. Okay, what did he do? He actually, you know, stripped himself, you know, full frontally, right, naked. Yeah, I mean, again, I can't see any reason for him to do that, but he did that. Okay. But the thing is that, you know, the fact that he's now allowed, he was allowed to do that without any getting into any trouble, except for smoking inside, you know. I mean, later on, I mean, in the original performance, you know, Joseph actually smoked and then stuck it on his armpit, and I think he wasn't allowed to smoke. I mean, that was the only restriction, but other than that,
he walked out to smoke.
He walked out to smoke, correct. Yeah, he wasn't allowed to smoke inside. Okay, and were you there? It was by invite only, I believe. So only, yes, right? So again, so it's a very closed door performance, right? Okay, but the fact that it was allowed, it was given the go ahead, right? Showed that maybe Singapore has come quite a long way from what happened in 1994. Okay, I'm going to show you, okay, maybe I'll finish the last one. Maybe before that, I'll show you Brother Kane, original performance. Okay. Now let me tell you that, unfortunately, you know, we have very few videos, right, taken of performance art, right, in the early year. And it's one of the rare few, okay, taken by Ray Legenda, who has written quite a lot on, okay, this particular episode. Okay, and come to, drum roll, please. Okay, no, that's okay. Okay, the first, right, defining moment, or rather on this list, right, okay? What I call a radical gesture. Okay, it happened in 1972. Now, at that time, there was this, he was studying, I think, this artist called Cho Chai Hyang, right? He was studying in Britain. And he was part of this society called the Modern Art Society, right? And the Modern Art Society was having an upcoming exhibition, and Cho Chai Hyang decided to send a proposal, okay, for this exhibition, right? And the proposal was actually just a set of instructions, right, to draw whatever it is, a square, a rectangle, okay, measuring 5 by 5 feet, okay, straddling both the wall and the floor. That was the instruction. Then that was the work they was proposing to do. And it's to be entitled Singapore River. Right? So when the president of the Modern Society, Ho Ho Ying, who was recently awarded the cultural medallion, okay, of course, when he received the proposal, maybe he was quite bewildered or even shocked. Okay? But he wrote back a letter to Cho Chai Hyang, right? Politely telling him that, you know, his work will not be accepted. Right? Although of course the Modern Art Society itself was a reaction, okay, to what was happening in Singapore painting at that time. You know, I mean, the Modern Society was a society that advocated abstract art. Okay, so it was a reaction against the kind of social realist art right, or the Nanyang art that were taking place, right, in Singapore at that time. Okay, but I think this work that was proposed by Cho Chai Hiang was a bit too much for Ho Ho Ying, okay, to accept. Okay, he was, for example, in his letter, he would. Oh, by the way, the letter is going to be republished in a book that myself and Sing Eugene, the senior curator at the National Gallery, we will, you know, it will be launched sometime in October, November. We hope earlier. Okay, it's a book of published writings on Singapore contemporary art. Okay, altogether there are 33 texts. Okay, so keep a lookout. And I'm happy to say that, you know, Ode to Art actually has sponsored the printing of the book. And it's also sponsored by LaSalle College. Right, so that's going to be the first compilation of writings on Singapore contemporary art. Also, Ho Ho Ying's letter will be republished in that book. And he said something like, well, the artwork has to strike at the sympathetic chords of viewers. Okay, meaning to say that he said that, you know, an artwork that was something that was proposed by Cho Chai Hiang, okay, cannot hope to engage the viewers because, you know, it simply lacked the aesthetic quality, right? And it will confuse people over, you know, what art is or what art is not. Okay, so in any case, you know, he kind of politely kind of rejected that work. Okay? And of course it wasn't, but later on, of course, that work was realized, okay, in a few places like the Singapore Museum. Okay, so this was what the work would have looked like if it was actually executed, okay, according to Cho Chai Hiang's instructions. Okay. Of course, you know, it's interesting also that in different places, right, you see the works, different kind of visual, the work appearing, differently, right, in different places, right? This one with neon lights, and then I think there's one that was done in China, okay? So there were different iterations of this particular work. Okay, so that's about it, right? Singapore River, okay? Sometimes there's a 5x5 following the title of Singapore River. Okay? Now, why entitled it Singapore River when it doesn't resemble a river? Okay? Cho Chai Hiang was trying to challenge the establishment, mainstream art, right? Because at that time, okay, many people were simply painting the Singapore River. Okay, they would just take the easel, right, the Singapore River, and okay, and paint what they saw. So it was, in a sense, like a critique against painting, a critique against, right, this the Singapore River itself, you know, and. Again, a challenge to people, right? In a sense, to push the boundaries of what art is about. Okay, and I think Cho Chai Hiang's thoughts is best captured in these writings which came out in a Chinese newspaper, right, or magazine. Okay, it's also going to be republished in that book, right? And it's called New Art, New Concepts. Okay, and you can see those, that's the list of, right? Essentially, I mean, he's saying that he's trying to challenge, okay, he's trying to challenge conventional ways of making art, right? Okay, and again, you know, I mean, Singapore 1970s, I mean, it was something that was it was a scene still dominated by painting, right? Of course, in the States and all that, in Europe, okay, artists were already doing such works, okay, cutting-edge practices, right, which push the boundaries. Okay, but in Singapore, it was something that was definitely new at that time. Okay, total rejection of formalism, even abstract art. Okay, incorporation of objects not previously considered as art in the process of making. Right, use of simple materials and ordinary objects. Okay, so what Cho Chai Hiang is telling people is that, well, people should be prepared, okay, to accept these new ways of making art, okay, which is inevitable that artists would resort, okay, to use such ways of making art. Right? So I suppose he was trying to test the ground, trying to push the boundaries, you know. And by that time, as I said, even the modern art society, however innovative, right, it kind of purports to be, was not prepared, okay, to accept such a radical gesture, such a radical work, as yet. Okay? And you know, it was only until 1988, some 16 years later, that you know, you see such kind of avant-garde practices happening with the artist village with Trimurti. Of course, in 1979, Tan Teng Kee burned, you know, he had a picnic where he burned one of his sculptures, you know. So that was thought to be the earliest act of performance art, okay? That was 1979. But these were random acts, okay? It didn't happen, as I said. 1972, you know, it only was 16 years later that a contemporary art scene incorporating what Cheo Chai Hiang advocated here, you know, actually kind of took place. Okay, I'm done. Thank you very much.